common when somebody's introduced like that to say, oh, I don't recognize myself in those comments. And of course, all I could think was, first, I've used two swear words in the world, and second, I owe Megan Malamud an email because she asked for a recommendation letter, and now I feel like I'm dropping the ball. So if you'll just give me 5 minutes, I'll go write that and then come right back. So, it's such a pleasure to deliver this. The Faith and Reason lecture was already a tradition when I arrived here, and so it seems like it's been here for all eternity because I wasn't there at the beginning. And there were already legends of the great lectures that had gone before. So it's great to be a sort of latecomer to this tradition. I want to share with you tonight what I would call one of the most remarkable puzzles of my life. And its main part, let's see if I can get this going here. Its main parts run as follows. First, it's a demonstrable truth that all genuine education involves the human person in a kind of initiation and liberation of the mind so that it may enter into the contemplation of truth, and that the properly and fully human life will be one shaped by the practice of contemplation. This is what it means for education to be liberal, and why it plays an essential role in human flourishing. But B, as a student at the University of Michigan 2 decades ago, the explicit education the university proposed to offer students in the classroom or in campus life was decidedly illiberal and consequently inhuman. I should therefore have been miseducated and a malformed person. But wait. Finally, despite that, I did in fact receive a liberal and humanizing education, not because I was expressly initiated into the contemplative life, but rather because I kept the company of writers. Those writers, faculty, graduate students, and undergraduate students alike, all shared in a single-minded commitment to craft, to the art of writing well. And this helped me to experience, through a communal reverence for the art and a shared concern for literary practice and form, what is normally conferred through education's commitment to shared dialectical inquiry, intellectual openness to the light of the real as such, and well-disciplined awe in the presence of the eternal. To explain this puzzle to myself and to share it with you, I want to offer a clear account of what contemplation and the contemplative life properly are, why work, specifically as the activity of making and craft, is normally thought to be definitively outside of it, but also why this thinking is not, on the whole, correct. There's an approach to the practice of a craft, the desire to make a good work, that is at once consummately practical and yet genuinely contemplative. This will lead to a final and, I hope, culminating reflection on my own work as a maker of poems that will reveal the poem as a craft work that is at once an object for contemplation, but also a genuine living out of the contemplative life. The imminent calculating movements of the mind at work as it tries to order words into a fitting form for all its practical activity is a way of entering into contemplation as it has been classically understood. The making of something new really can be a way of dwelling in the presence of the eternal truth, of eternal truth, and catching a glimpse of those permanent things. Before undertaking all that, it's worth pausing to explain what I mean in calling the university where I studied as in principle illiberal and dehumanizing. During the last few years, we've all heard troubling stories of certain kinds of inconvenient speech being silenced on campuses, of professors being shamed or shouted down for offending one sensibility or another, with a seemingly innocent statement of what might otherwise have been deemed common sense, of students feeling attacked by the professors for not towing a particular political line, and of students themselves protesting their college administrators for not being woke, for not being politically engaged enough with identity politics fashions of our times. The criticisms of these events often occur at a fairly modest and insubstantial register, with commentators complaining about the loss of free speech, the narcissistic self-righteousness of a few, or the infantilized sensitivities of the many. Often enough, these episodes are used to criticize the leftist politics of professors or of academia as a whole. What's less often noted is that in every instance, we see the university as understood by these those inside and outside it as essentially a political institution, of politics understood as Karl Marx understood it, as merely the attaining or wielding of power, and of there being absolutely nothing beyond politics. I say less often noted, but even as I was preparing these remarks for you, my colleagues, Drs. Steve McGuire and John Paul Spiro, were publishing a superb commentary in the Philadelphia Inquirer, making just these points. If it seems at times that the college classroom has become a place either to air certain political grievances or conversely, where one comes despite one's better judgment to feel aggrieved by the airing, this is nothing new. What we see in our hour is in fact the exacerbation, or rather the logical working out, of academic life as it stood two decades ago and more. Then, as now, many scholars and students alike could conceive of nothing transcending the politics of power. They could not even imagine such a thing. Then, as now, truth and wisdom are shrugged off as the tools of the powerful or as a means to future power, but as having no reality proper to themselves and transcending the contestations of our day. Then, as now, most sensible students would simply hustle through their education, disengaged and buffered by contempt or indifference before this politicization of the university. Whether they recognize it or not, they experience that this absolutization of power makes getting a liberal education impossible, and so they resolve to get out of college as quickly as they can. They will hurry past the angry mobs protesting outside this or that administration building on their way to finding some kind of profitable work on the far side of their degree. Then at last they imagine honest work can begin. Now, my friends in school did not think this way. We were not looking ahead to some lucrative career that bore little direct relation to the reading of books and the life of the mind proper to study. And we were not so naive as to think that the life of the mind was finding authentic expression in the routine protests for some political cause that intermittently fevered our campus, as if enlightenment were chiefly a matter of finding new things at which to be offended. We knew that there was something genuinely good in the world to be had, that was neither reducible to wealth nor expressible as power. When we could, we studied with older professors who still cherished wisdom and contemplation, but on the whole, we did not look to gain our education in the classroom. We found it in conversation with the handful of practicing poets and novelists who taught on campus and those who came to read their work. We found it, above all, in discussion with one another. In the winter of my sophomore year, I had discovered a handful of other young people who loved books so much that they were trying to write them, who loved, in particular, the stories and novels of Joyce, of Hemingway, of Moore, Carver, and Dostoevsky. They loved them because to read such books was to come to see the world in a different, richer way, and to live differently, more richly, in consequence. And because they saw these books were great, they wanted to write some of their own just as good. These were not the books being taught in most classrooms, of course, and when they were, it was, in the words of one professor, only to undo them. We did not go to our classes to read books and learn about them. We went to one another's hovels in the student ghetto. There we convened to talk about our own work, to tear it apart, and to show one another why it was not yet doing what it needed to do. We read the books we loved, with an eye to seeing how they worked, how they were crafted. And we hectored one another and demanded of ourselves that we would master this craft of writing so that we could produce in our lives perhaps some one permanent work. Some of us may have had sympathy for the politics behind our professor's deconstruction of good books, or for the rallies and protests that were the background noise of our daily lives. But the test for what we cared about most was what might be called that of good craft as a sign of truth. What is it that these good books do that is good, we asked? What do I have to do to make a good story? We saw that the absolutized politics around us was useless in answering these questions. We saw also something more, and to this I shall return. We saw that the crafting of a story form, of choosing words and composing sentences, and producing finally the complete form of a work, bore a mysterious but palpable analogy to seeing the form of truth and of reshaping one's own life so as to conform to it. We saw in the shape of myth, in outline, even a revelation of logos. Those shouting in righteous indignation seemed incapable of perceiving this, and more, their whole way of being seemed a disfigurement of it, though we couldn't have said why. I certainly couldn't have explained it to you. We totally lacked in philosophical resources almost as badly as did the professors of philosophy. Our whole way of thinking and talking was in terms of myth and technique, those concrete modes of story form and art form. But in brief, in the discipline of craft, we found something akin to what I would only later come to understand as the contemplative life that everyone from Christ and Plato to St. Augustine, E.F. Schumacher, and Joseph Pieper have understood as the true secret, the soul fulfillment, and the honest act of human life. So what is the contemplative life? Why it should be surprising that the practice of literary craft somehow participates in the contemplative life, and why the contemplative life should be the truly excellent form of human life to which education properly must be committed, is not really that obvious. Some of us, many of us, find school a grind to be gotten out of quickly and in one piece. And though many of us may find thinking a nice thing to do, no less a figure than blessed John Henry Newman once proposed that life is for action, whereas contemplation seems hardly an activity at all. And so let me offer just a brief account of contemplation now. Writing amid the ruins of Germany after the Second World War, the philosopher Joseph Pieper knew well the temptation to think of life in terms of action, that is to say, in terms of work. An entire society had to be rebuilt from rubble. Contemplation requires leisure, and leisure had come to appear as an irresponsible sort of laziness. It did not help that the ideologies of the modern age, from John Locke and Adam Smith to Karl Marx, seemed to define human nature in terms of productive labor and work, or that the most influential German philosopher of all time, Immanuel Kant, attempted to redefine philosophy itself as a contemplative, not as a contemplative love of wisdom, but as a species of intellectual labor. Important as these things are, Pieper argued it's essential to the human person to reach beyond the province of the human and into the order of the angels, the truly intellectual beings. And this can be done only if we silence the roving and clinking business that we associate with ratio, discursive reason, and fall back into the patient and receptive faculty on which all reasoning is founded, and which Pieper rightly calls intellectus. Ratio is a power of active manipulation, dissection, and examination. But intellectus is, in Pieper's words, that simple vision to which truth offers itself like a landscape to the eye. It is the capacity to receive the gift and grace of the world as knowable, as wonderful, and which defines us as truth-knowing beings. E.F. Schumacher, in A Guide for the Perplexed, would later underscore that all our knowledge culminates in seeing, in what I've elsewhere called the vision of the soul. When we are in the full presence of truth, we know it because we see it. The mind no longer grapples and strains, but receives the fullness of the form of truth. However passive and at peace the mind in contemplation may appear, it is not only active, but in a state of consummate activity. Its stillness derives from the mind's having no further place to travel because all it desires stands above it already in vision. The modern French philosopher, Jacques Maritain, notes that this apparent finality and passivity is specifically due to the act of contemplation as being wholly within the one contemplating. The intellect acts, he writes, indeed, its act is, absolutely speaking, life par excellence. But its act is an immanent act, which remains wholly within the intellect to perfect it, and through which the intellect, with a limitless veracity, sees as being and draws it into itself. It eats being and drinks being. Elsewhere, he writes of philosophical contemplation as absolutely useless and absolutely necessary, for truth is the food of the spirit, he says. Dining on such fare, one may indeed be less avid for outward reasoning and action, but only because one has already been so amply surfeited. Contemplation, evidently, may best be thought of as being at leisure, a reclining at the full spread table of being itself, wherein one indicates one's contentment simply by being in no rush to push back one's chair and to rise. Why, however, should this apparent indigence be judged not just a fine bit of recreation, but the properly human life? Why should a genuinely humanizing education be characterized as just that which liberates one for and even initiates one into contemplation? The oldest answer to these questions is still the best one. Those of you who have read Aristotle's On the Soul, I'm looking at you, will recall, because it's all of you, will recall that he says that there that the purpose and perfection of every living thing must be determined by the best thing in it, and this will be its highest faculty or power. Midterm exam, question 3. A plant, wish we could go back in time now, right? A plant fulfills itself in growth and reproduction and nothing more or other, because these are the only faculties it has. We human beings comprehend such a faculty and many others, but all of them underneath and within the power of thought. The capacity to think specifies our natures. A good plant will be fertile, and we may praise it as fruitful. A good person will be one who puts his highest power into action most fully. And to be so fully active in fulfilling one's purpose, Aristotle tells us, is to be happy. In his Nicomachean Ethics, he tells us that it must be the case, therefore, that our happiness lies in the life of contemplation. Thinking governs every other faculty found within us, and so all else is subservient to it. Further, we have the capacity not just to think and govern by thinking, things inferior to thought itself. To the contrary, thought has the potential to rise up above the merely human and to form a conception about things that are beautiful and divine. As such, this power of thought seems itself to be the most divine thing in us, he says, a trace of the God, the most formidable act and the most continuous thing in which we may engage. It produces nothing beyond itself, and yet it is beautiful in itself and requires no expression beyond itself. While other actions may have a beautiful outward expression, they are themselves associated with an external striving and exhaustion, and so are not completely beautiful, Aristotle says. Contemplation, in contrast, has at most an inward striving, because its life would seem to be greater than what accords with a human being. It is to live in accord with that divinity present in us, and to strain whatever is merely human to conform to the superhuman, so that, as Aristotle puts it, we come to participate in the life and activity of the gods. Aristotle several times says that this happiness is indeed the blessed life, and so we'll not be surprised to hear St. Thomas Aquinas instruct us that the beatific vision, the contemplation of God himself, is the one true happiness for human beings. The highest activity of the person is thought. The object of thought is reality, by which he means truth's being. The highest truth will be being itself, and Aquinas notes this everyone calls God. Only God in his infinite simplicity is inexhaustible and unsurpassable as an object of thought, and so finally only God can be a wholly satisfactory object of contemplation, insofar as contemplation is thinking that has no need to go beyond its object and so finds rest in its presence. Education is liberal, insofar as it gives one the means to enter into just such contemplation, to be free, relatively, if not absolutely, from all that prevents the mind's entering into the presence of that place where truth gives itself to us as vision. So craft work as bonosic, or fulfillment. What I've just said, Aquinas argues in the Summa Contra Gentiles. In those same pages, he entertains competing arguments about the nature of human happiness, demonstrating that each of them fails where contemplation succeeds as the real thing. Among the competitors is artistic activity, the making of things. This, he says, cannot be our happiness. We engage in practical activities which are useful so that we may engage in those activities that are both highest and good in themselves. But only contemplation is in accord with what is highest in us and wholly contains its own goodness. Further, we manufacture things not for themselves, but for our own use. A thing made cannot be its own end, much less ours. This could be taken for granted by the ancient philosophers. While Plato and Aristotle made frequent references to craftsmanship in order to explain the relationship between knowledge and activity, speculation and practicality, they saw the benosic, that is to say, the life defined by work and labor, as clearly inferior to the life defined by thought and freedom. It was not for its own sake. No one lives to work, but rather works in order to live. That's one of those motivation posters that's actually true. And further, everyone works to some extent. It is all too common, but clearly not everyone lives a life that can be judged happy. Work cannot be the necessary condition for happiness, and to the extent that its necessities take time away from something better, it may even become a kind of evil. I've always thought work was very evil. Expressed thus, these conclusions will strike most of us as partial at best. Don't we want to be useful? Some of you will have read Dorothy Sayers' great essay, Why Work? There she praises the discipline and asceticism of good work, of giving oneself over to a task in an act of self-abnegation for the good of the thing to be made. For Sayers, honest work is an example of integrity and good order that affirms the goodness of life in the world. It is a properly human habit of being. Further, Catholic social doctrine has as one of its founding principles the dignity proper to human labor. In St. John Paul II's encyclical Laborum Exercens, he observes that whatever else human beings share with other animals, only man works. From God's first commandment in the Garden of Eden, man's work has been his means of cooperating in the proper order of the world and of making it a fruitful place. If through sin, labor admits to itself the elements of sweat and tears, of pain and exhaustion, this is secondary to its positive dignity, he tells us. Indeed, the central element of work is what the Pope calls its subjective dimension. By engaging with what he calls the great workbench of the world, man develops himself, becomes more fully himself, even as he also produces an artifact beyond or outside of himself. Jacques Maritain, whom I mentioned above in the context of contemplation as the human good, was also a central influence on Sayers' thought and indeed probably helped shape the Pope's thinking on the dignity of work as well. He did this in a passage like this one, where he writes, "The artisan is the normal type of human development, in the normal type of human development and of truly human civilizations, represents the general run of men. If Christ willed to be an artisan in a little village, it's because he wanted to assume the common condition of humanity. The common and the general are not necessarily positive attributes, though they should indicate a conformity with human nature. But Christ as carpenter does reveal something, or rather brought about what John Paul II calls a fundamental change in our thinking about work. The Christian can no longer dismiss the central feature of our lives as merely benostic, merely servile." John Paul and Maritain both place a limit on this change, however. John Paul insists that because work is finally for the sake of this subjective dimension, the development of man himself, it must be in accord with human dignity, involve the fullness of his being as a free person, and this includes his having ownership over what he produces. The Pope envisions this as man's continuing participation in God's creative activity. Maritain specifies this in a profound way. Man bears the divine image precisely because of his intellect, and he emulates God as creator only insofar as this intellect produces something outside itself. That is to say, the truly human work is that of making. Artistic work is thus the properly human work, Maritain writes, and this is in contradistinction to the work of a beast or the work of a machine, or a man made to work like a beast or a machine. The intellectual virtue of art, the ordination of the mind to making something, is the primary source of work's human goodness. The artist, the craftsman, manifests this dignity most fully. So I want to turn now to craft as a mystery of being. Most of us will readily concede, then, that work as making, governed by the craft of the intellect and directed to bring an object into being outside of itself, has its own dignity. But to deny the transcendent dignity of the contemplative life by equating these two activities, thought and work, would be to disregard what Aristotle called the best thing in us. What if, however, it were not the case that work was simply equal to contemplation, but that work, when it attains to craft or art, bears within it a genuinely contemplative activity or end? One of the most odd and captivating illustrations of this possibility occurs in a novel that many of you will have read, Joyce's Portrait of the Artist as a Young Man. In the book's second part, young Stephen Dedalus has fallen in love with a literary heroine named Mercedes from The Count of Monte Cristo. He aspires to be a writer and to save himself and his family from poverty and squalor by means of his pen. And he has had a touching encounter with a young girl named Emma who rides home with him from a party one night through the streets of Dublin on a horse-drawn tram. As they mount up and down the steps of the tram, playful and nervous in the warmth of one another's presence, young Stephen wishes to kiss her but does not. Here's what happened afterward. The next day, he sat at his table in the bare upper room for many hours. Before him lay a new pen, a new bottle of ink, and a new emerald exercise. From force of habit, he'd written at the top of the first page the initial letters of the Jesuit motto, AMDG. On the first line of the page appeared the title of the verses he was trying to write, to E.C. He knew it was right to begin so, for he had seen similar titles in the collected poems of Lord Byron. When he had written this title and drawn an ornamental line underneath, he fell into a daydream and began to draw diagrams on the cover of the book. His mind wanders, and he almost fails, but then, by dint of brooding on the incident, he thought himself into confidence. During this process, all those elements from the encounter with Emma, which he deemed common and insignificant, fell out of the scene. There remained no trace of the tram itself, nor of the tram men, nor the horses. Nor did he and she appear vividly. The verses told only of the night and the balmy breeze and the maiden luster of the moon. Some undefined sorrow was hidden in the hearts of the protagonists as they stood in silence beneath the leafless trees. And when the moment of farewell had come, the kiss which had been withheld by one was given by both. After this, the letters L, D, S were written at the foot of the page. And having hidden the book, he went into his mother's bedroom and gazed at his face for a long time in the mirror of her dressing table. There are patronizing elements here, to be sure, as a mature artist looks back upon the wee spud he once was and laughs at himself. Stephen knows it is right to title his poem a particular way only because Lord Byron, the great romantic poet, did so first. In his composition, everything that really made the encounter a vivid reality is burned away, leaving only the stereotype banalities of a sentimental love poem. Oh, moon, it begins, no doubt. Items Joyce shows his contempt for simply by suppressing them. He brackets the whole effort with that child's image of high seriousness, the Jesuit mottos that indicate a school exercise. And finally, he hides this agglutination of cliches as if it were Aladdin's magic lamp before he goes to a mirror and stares upon himself with what Joyce intends for us to recognize as vanity. The humiliating fragility of all vanity will become a central theme in this part of the novel. But I don't think that's all we find there. Or rather, it's not the only way Joyce allows us to read this passage. So let's try another. Young Stephen can only begin to write when he feels the traditions of a craft, the intellectual seriousness of the Jesuits, and the achievement of Byron guiding his pen. As those of you who have taken the world course know, true creation is always from nothing, but the artist has nothing he has not first received. Remember that for the final. Without first receiving these traditions and conventions, Stephen or any artist could do nothing. He is too green to recognize that he has thrown the best part of his experience out the window and is merely reciting the incidental images and feelings of others he has encountered in literature. But Stephen could not have perceived the occasion for a poem without those borrowed images first giving him a frame. And furthermore, Joyce suggests to us what a truly good poem would have contained. Indeed, he's already given us the poem. He wrote it 2 pages earlier in the prose of his novel. But all this pales before what comes next. Stephen senses that in making this thing, in writing this poem, he has awakened to a great mystery. He does not know what to do with it, and so he hides it away as a precious thing. When my children come across strange pieces of plastic, colorful rocks, odd papers, and myriad other things, they hoard and hide them about the house. I have even come across whole bags of bottle caps. Objects, when they are full of strangeness and wonder, can excite us with a sense of magic. Unfortunately for me, the magic tends to wear off once an object has been hidden and forgotten, and I'm left to discover unwelcome collections while merely trying to vacuum. Stephen does not yet know his poem in itself is bad, but he knows that bringing it to birth is something miraculous. And then, finally, he does something even more definitive. He goes into his mother's bedroom and gazes at his face for a long time in the mirror of her dressing table. You could almost hear his pulse loudened, his body trembling, and he wants to stare into the source of the mystery that has just come upon him. Vanity, for sure, but his being has been grazed by an entirely new way of life. To stare into his own reflection is not so much self-possession as a standing in wonder before the unanticipated, the ecstatic, where some new thing has been drawn out of the self and brought into the world. In the last pages of the novel, an almost, but not quite, mature Stephen will proclaim to himself that this is all he wants in life, to give birth to the beauty that has not yet come into the world. The making of a poem, the putting of a poem out into the world, has been a means of entering into the depths of the mystery of being. The process of its birth, its making, must therefore have been a species of contemplation, where forming and seeing become one. Do we not find in this portrait of Stephen, staring at himself in the mirror, an echo of Augustine's confessions when he prays to our Lord, "Late have I loved you, beauty so ancient and so new. Late have I loved you. Lo, you were within, but I was outside seeking there for you." Only a mirror can turn his outward gaze back inward toward God. During the Middle Ages, as it happens, the two wives of Jacob in Genesis, Leah and Rachel, were taken as figures of the active and contemplative life, and Rachel was depicted as gazing ever on her reflection in a mirror. Dante writes, for instance, in Purgatorio 27, of Sister Rachel, who never deserts her mirror. There she sits all day. She longs to see her fair eyes gazing. The 12th century theologian Richard of St. Victor, also invoking Rachel, instructs us that whoever thirsts to see his God, let him wipe his mirror. When it has been wiped and gazed into for a long time, a kind of splendor of divine light begins to shine in it, and a great beam of unexpected vision appears in his eyes. Consider also the 17th century paintings of Georges de Latour, where faces gazing in mirrors become symbols of vain distraction, yes, but mostly of contemplation, and the paintings themselves become a mirror of contemplation for our own souls, stirring us from vanity to self-knowledge and the knowledge of God. Yes, it may be a bad poem, Stephen's poem, but through the work of drawing out of himself, by means of the conventions and traditions of his craft, a new object to take its place in the world, he has become conscious of a power and a mystery he could scarcely have suspected before. Maritain tells us that there is a pathos to this particular kind of making. The object of the gaze of the contemplative is not only being itself and truth itself, but as Augustine just told us, it's the divine beauty. Work as making has its good in the thing made. The fine artist, such as our young Stephen, has the good of his work in the manifestation of beauty and the making of a beautiful thing. And so, Maritain writes, the artist has for object a spiritual absolute, the divine beauty, and yet is forced, like a servant, to toil in the merely material means of manifesting it. Despite its divine and spiritual object, Maritain tells us, art remains in the order of making, and it is by drudgery upon some matter that it aims at delighting the spirit. Hence, for the artist, a strange and saddening condition, image itself of man's condition in the world, where he must wear himself out among bodies and live with the spirits. Maritain makes it seem that the artist has a divine vocation in spite of the very essence of his activity, rather than because of it. It is this claim of the artist as pained victim of discord that I want to criticize next. So, poiesis, finding the form as the fullness of being. Those of you who've read the Phaedrus, and I know there's a few of you, or at least the part of it with me, will know that when Plato, or Socrates rather, reveals the highest truths, he does it in a poem. Fewer of you will have read George Putnam's Guide to Prosody, but you should. And Putnam, writing in the 17th century, actually at the end of the 16th century, tells us that the poet is the first priest, the first philosopher, he's also the first weatherman, the first performer, the founder of political society. Poets have done a lot of really good things. So in the words of Trump, it's really, really good. So it's great. So really, I shouldn't have to look too hard to justify this. I have to tell you, and this is a bit of a digression, but it's theorized that if Shakespeare wasn't Shakespeare or a man of the same name, that George Putnam may have been the author of Shakespeare's plays. And George Putnam is an ancestor of T.S. Eliot. So if you buy into conspiracy theories, and hey, why not? It's quite possible that Shakespeare and T.S. Eliot are relatives. So when you discuss. Anyhow, so we have these antecedents in Plato, in Putnam, who tell us that there's something genuinely revelatory about the poetic, about making. But why should the form of the thing made be responsible for the discovery of what the work finally discloses to us? Long before I had heard of Putnam, or speculated on his ancestry or his descendants, or read any Plato, I'd reached a conclusion akin to Putnam's and Plato's, and for two reasons. First, in my search for models to guide me in the quest to write well, I had come across the work of the great poet and critic, Ivor Winters. I can't say that name without getting excited. It was around the time of this discovery that, partly under the influence of his example, I abandoned the writing of prose fiction in favor of the writing of poetry. Winters was the first writer I'd ever seen who could explain with clarity and seriousness the truth-revealing power of art. His brief definition of poetry was as a statement in language about human experience, more or less rational, using both connotation and denotation, and usually metrical. Sounds very academic. Okay. He elaborates on its function in the following passage from his essay, The Morality of Poetry. The conception which I'm trying to define is a conception of poetry as a technique of contemplation, of comprehension, a technique which does not eliminate the need for philosophy or religion, but which, rather, completes and enriches them. And a few pages further on, he concludes, poetry should offer a means of enriching one's awareness of human experience and of so rendering greater the possibility of intelligence in the course of future action. and it should offer likewise a means of inducing certain more or less constant habits of feeling, which should render greater the possibility of one's acting in a future situation in accordance with the findings of one's improved intelligence. It is the richest and most perfect technique of contemplation. I didn't read these sentences first, so that's not what made me fall in love with Winters, but he's right here. Poetry was itself a technique of contemplation, and not just for the reader who might contemplate it as an object, but for the poet in the calm, methodical act of discernment, the finding of form that is poetic composition. Winters' expression of this point is somewhat irritatingly moralized insofar as it emphasizes action at the expense of a rich awareness of contemplation as an end above all other ends. But overall, his is the most satisfactory account of art's craft as joined to contemplation that I have found, and I say this after many years of looking for better ones. My own experience as a writer was a source of further conviction about Plato, Putnam, and Winters' insight. During last year's Faith and Reason lecture, some of you will remember Dr. Hughes recommended writing because it gives roots to thought. This sounded correct to me at the time, and indeed I'd even go a bit further. We are all accustomed to distinguishing thought and expression, as if an idea could be good, and yet the manifestation of it poor, or vice versa. There must be some truth to this. Rhetorical style is not itself sound reasoning. But if composition in verse really is a technique of contemplation, then style and substance must be much more deeply intertwined than is usually claimed. We should take thought that, according to every one of the guides to the meaning of contemplation I've cited, to see the truth in contemplation is indeed to see the form of being, the form of truth. And to write is to give form to an idea, intellectual form, and written form, ontological form, and aesthetic form must touch one another. In mere rhetoric, the form of language may just be a falsifying image of the concealed or overwritten form of truth. Such is the risk of things being distinguishable and separable in our world. But when rhetoric is practiced with a concern for truth, when its operations are ordered by being, then the finding of the form of the work to be made becomes also an inquiry into the finding out and discovery of the form of the real. In poetry, where every syllable is measured and tested for its integrity, the totality of the aesthetic form becomes the genuine fullness of being, its defined order and refulgent splendor in one of the thought that it alone makes actual in the world. Content and form, idea and expression may be distinct in reason, but they are one in being. So, finding of a form for dark places. I've been talking rather theoretically about practice, which, as Yogi Berra says, is great in theory, but in practice, not so much. So I'd like to conclude by turning to one of my own poems, one that, as it happens, reflects on some of the themes that we've been considering tonight, and to reconstruct in an admittedly simulated or even fake way the movement of the mind as it tries to realize a thought by finding its adequate form. It's a commonplace to observe that people in the modern age tend to be doubtful about the practice of contemplation because they are doubtful about the capacities of reason. And their doubt about reason stems from a doubt that the world outside the mind is properly knowable, or, even worse, worth knowing. Yes, we're confident that reason can be used to gain a certain control or domination over the stuff of nature, but using stuff and knowing the world are two different things. When we look out at the world, on this account anyway, we tend to see the abyss of space receding into infinity, such that what little we think we know seems inadequate and alien. That quintessentially modern figure, the mathematician Blaise Pascal, wrote of the universe, "The eternal silence of these infinite spaces frightens me." The universe is dark and silent space, wherein the word space is used to highlight its limitless abstraction and darkness in indication of emptiness, of absence. The French symbolist poet Stéphane Mallarmé modified Pascal's image to express something Pascal's black abyss doesn't quite capture. Mallarmé speaks of the sky above us as the everlasting azure that dwells in a tranquil irony. What is the irony of the sky, the irony of the blue? It is indeed a dead abyss, he tells us, that overwhelms us. But also, in its monochromatic domination, it stands as an image of the absolute we cannot attain. If you ever wonder why you go into a museum of modern art and you walk into the modernist gallery and there's a blank canvas before you, or just a plain blue painted one, it's because somebody was trying to capture this absolute of the blue sky that Mallarmé is talking about. It's a striving for this absolute. It is the simultaneous appearance of all and nothing, that blue sky, and both rebuke us. Mallarmé seeks unsuccessfully to blot out this witness of the absolute with darkness or fog, or to bury himself in the material, but he cannot. And so the poem ends, "Je suis hanté l'azur, l'azur, l'azur." I am haunted, the sky, the sky, the sky. A much more modest poet, Philip Larkin, in his poem High Windows, looked at his age of casual sex and meaningless freedom and thought of high windows, out of which one looks and sees beyond it the deep blue air that shows nothing and is nowhere and is endless. The deep blue sky, for these, is no symbol of peace, but of anxiety before an infinite and absolute, the divine, that just seems too far from us. And so, like Stephen, I sat at my desk, not with a new emerald notebook, and wrote, "You stare into the azure distances that eyes cannot exceed. Empty freedom terrifies us. So does an absolute that speaks to us only with a superior irony." In America, in the middle of the 19th century, this desire to encounter the absolute and to be neighborly with it, to see and hear God, became a great source of anxiety. In proper American fashion, anxiety fed into capitalist ambition, and thus was born the transcendentalist movement. One of the very great, but forgotten figures of the movement was a poet named Jones Very. I know of Jones Very only because Ivor Winters admired him and wrote about his poetry. Very, Winters tells us, shocked and confused people like Ralph Waldo Emerson, because while Emerson loved to write lectures on the importance of submitting oneself to the direct guidance of the divine spirit of nature, Very actually did it and lived his life in mystical communion with God. Emerson and his age paid Very the compliment of judging him insane, Winters says, because when it came to living out transcendentalist principles, Emerson was a mere charlatan, while Very was the genuine article. Others hungered doubtfully for the communion Very enjoyed, and he addressed them in a sonnet, concluding, and for those of you in the verse class, this is the sestet, "But now you hear us talk as strangers, met above the room wherein you lie abed. A word perhaps loud spoken you may get, or hear our feet when heavily we tread. But he who speaks, or him who's spoken to, must both remain as strangers still to you." The hope against the blank blue of the sky is to hear an answering voice, one that is of the spirit, divine, but audibly present. And nothing answers a voice more profoundly than a rhyme. But there are different uses of rhyme, some more musical and some more jarring. Envelope rhyming can be either, but when it's done with lines of dissimilar length, one can alternately conceal the rhyme one moment and then have it clash strikingly at another. And so I wrote, "You stare into the azure distances that eyes cannot exceed. A serious voice bleeds through the wall, but you don't hear what it says." We have now a stanza of iambic pentameter, two trimeters, and a final pentameter, capped off by the envelope rhyme scheme of ABBA, right, Vaish? Also a problem, a certain yearning for a divinity that seems not to give itself. It is either too dark or azure, and yet hints of its presence for which one feels longing and a walled-off sense of exclusion. Just this experience was had by someone very close to me. A person of no religious faith, she'd lost her mother at a young age to a terrible disease. She and her mother had only two only a few things deeply in common, and these included just this lack of faith and, more happily, a love of crossword puzzles. This person once tried to pray to that ever-receding azure, I suppose, and promised that if she could just have some sign that her mother's soul was still alive somewhere, she would give herself in faith to God. For months after her mother's death, she would awaken in the darkness and see objects that were, to the best of her recollection, moved about, a doll suddenly at the foot of the bed, a creak in the door. It was as if the house itself were moving and trying to speak to her. One night, sitting at her crossword puzzle, she answered a clue, and the answer was love, L-O-V-E. The next clue's answer was you, Y-O-U. She saw another and immediately answered it, by, B-Y-E. Still another's answer, from. And just below the from were two sets of blocks, and without even looking at the clues, she filled in her mother's name. That was, as it turned out, the correct answer. And so I wrote, at night you fold the paper in your lap to solve the crossword. As descending letters pass onto the page, you sense a code, perhaps a whole vocabulary meant for you that you may never speak. The bedroom windows creak as if your mother, 3 years dead, brings news. We are waiting for the world in the full depths of its meaning to bring us news, to tell us not how unutterably alien it is, but why we should be of it, a part of it, our happiness dependent on its beauty. Alien or self-giving, divinely ordered or empty and receding, we sense that our deepest longing is for the real, for reality in its fullness. We sense that supersaturated in divinity as the sacrament of divine love, haunted by depths we had never before suspected, or tranquil in its black irony as a cosmic joke that frustrates us at every turn, we long for the real and are refused its fullness only because it is either more or less than we perceive. It never quite submits to what we may say about it because we always say too much or never enough. And so I wrote, the real repels our words or swallows them. I once came across an essay called The Logic of Mysticism by the English philosopher Herbert McCabe, which was a reflection on the theory of language by Ludwig Wittgenstein. Somewhere, McCabe proposes that our ordinary use of language is definite in the sense that we speak a word and the word contains within itself its kind of implicit definition. But often, he says, we use words in a gestural fashion. The word itself is empty of definition, but it points towards something it cannot define because it is impassably beyond itself. When Christ revealed himself and his divinity to the apostles, you'll recall Peter immediately wanted to build an altar of sorts to commemorate the vision of transfiguration. Your friend Thomas Hobbes tells us that anything dark or invisible man can fear may be the occasion for him naming it some kind of God. And though Hobbes seems to think this is a foolish thing to do, and it may be, to the contrary, rather honest to recognize that everything mysterious really is divine in some sense, because meaning is spiritual and the spirit never fully reveals itself. The spiritual always exceeds our words, so that the best words we can use in their regard are not words of definition, but words of worship, awe, fear, and praise. Hobbes himself believed reason tells us nothing else but that we should reverence invisible powers with all the pomp and ceremony by which we might placate a visible one, such as a king. Further, it's a principle of Catholic belief that the rule of prayer confers the rule of faith. Our explicit beliefs only follow from our form of prayer. This act of pointing to or anointing in worship divine things involves a certain failure of speech as we go beyond ourselves. In order to capture just how beyond we go in an encounter with the absolute, Maritain once wrote that we do not so much know as suffer things divine. And so I wrote next, all we can do is point in agony, anoint in ecstasy, our stuttering intent. Again, this absolute beyond us may be a brilliance or an emptiness, or both together, precisely because, as Aquinas tells us, God is infinite, eternal, and simple, and is to be viewed as an excess of intelligibility rather than as an unknowable other. Every positive statement we make about him in what is called cataphatic theology will finally be negated and surpassed by an apophatic negative turn, where we recognize with new consciousness the uncircumscribed meaning of the words we use. We will see then, in turning to what transcends us and is so much above us, the sky's bright emptiness reduced to phrases imploding definition. But recall the mirror of contemplation looked into by Stephen, Augustine, or Rachel. To go above ourselves cannot literally mean journeying outward into the azure, for there we find only an infinity of space. It entails rather going inward. We turn inward upon the events found in memory, which Augustine compares to a particular place, a mansion with many rooms. In the Confessions, Augustine moves through the years of his life as if each were a distinct chamber, examining the objects that are the events of his days, searching without success for God. He soon discovers he must go beyond concise confessions. God is no mere object stored in the memory, but rather dwells in a deeper place at the source of memory itself. But how does one arrive at this place where the self and its memory meet God, who is both present to it as creator and infinitely beyond it? Our ancient stories give a common answer. One must, with Odysseus, Aeneas, or Dante, make a journey not into the abyss of blue spaces, but into those dark places of the underworld, into the interior of the world that no routine act of man or memory can reach. Into such places, the dead carry coins for a lift on Charon's boat. Odysseus, in search of wisdom, brought blood to the underworld to feed the shade of the prophet Tiresias. Deep in the past, the first artifacts of writing we have were written on bones, as if only the dead could give us the wisdom we require. We do not wish merely to encounter the divine truth and watch our words fail, our stares flinch in awe and frustration. If all we can do is point with our words, and if our own definitions implode in their inadequacy, we still want to hear, not through the wall, but in our own presence, some full, adequate word of truth. But that word cannot be our own. It must be given to us from out of the depths by God himself. Virgil writes of Hades that it's easier to get in than get out, to carry off those coins than to return them as visible signs to the world. And so we wait and wait for those tokens of the underworld, for the coins, carved bones, and blood brought from dark places. So now we know the object of our contemplation, a word beyond ourselves and yet emerging from the deepest recesses of ourselves, if, and only if, we can find a means to discipline the mind and to make it receptive to the wisdom patiently, sometimes eerily, waiting to give itself. Line by line, we toil to find our way to a place where we can hear what comes from those dark places. And we end up with this, dark places. You stare into the azure distances that eyes cannot exceed. A serious voice bleeds through the wall, but you don't hear what it says. At night, you fold the paper in your lap to solve the crossword. As descending letters pass onto the page, you sense a code, perhaps a whole vocabulary meant for you, that you may never speak. The bedroom windows creak as if your mother, 3 years dead, brings news. The real repels our words or swallows them. All we can do is point in agony, anoint in ecstasy our stuttering intent. The sky's bright emptiness reduced to phrases imploding definitions, beyond concise confessions, the coins, carved bones, and blood brought from dark places. Thank you. Oh, there's one over there.
Just to bring up the point about liturgy and the fact that, you know, we don't read the Summa Contra Gentile in liturgy. We read in Dorje Devote, or we sing it, actually. You know, and so much of much of our liturgical action as Catholics is really based on psalms, which are poetry in themselves. So can you talk about that and how the relationship maybe between poetic expression and liturgical action?
So you caught me wanting to go in two directions. It's astonishing to me that Plato, who supposedly didn't like the poets, in fact recognizes that the poetic use of speech, the speech that's given to us, the part the muses give us, as he calls it, speech rendered perfect by meter, by rhythm, somehow is the only suitable medium for revelation. That it's speech brought to perfection, and in its perfection, it's showing the fullness of reality. And that observation on his part is one that the Western tradition has always had before it. We recognize in the poetic not just an odd use of speech, but actually the finest refinement of speech. So whatever's most important to be said is to be said in poetry. And what makes it so refined, it's, again, this is quoting Diotima in the Symposium, it's that poetry is the part of making that the muses give us in melody and in rhythm. It's the kind of speech where the formal properties of speech become consummately evident to us. And we, in our lives, are always seeking to have our lives be fully formed. And so we take the formed speech of words, such as the Psalms, and we try to extend them out into the world. And the first place we see that is in liturgy, in ritual that's directed to what transcends us. And then, of course, we seek to extend that form even further outward until our whole lives have become a liturgy, our whole lives have become a prayer. And so one way of thinking of culture is that it's the further extension of the formal properties of prayer, of cult, and at the heart of cult is this initial formal property of language properly formed as poetry. So you might say that the whole of the world radiates out from a poem. So yeah, I think so. Tony.
Talk more about what the, do you think the actual difference is between action and contemplation? Because it seems like from what you're saying about writing a poem, just like with any sort of craft, I think that act and contemplation are bound up together in this any activity, whether it's leather work or
yeah. Yeah.
But nonetheless, they seem like distinct concepts.
Yeah. Yeah. That's right. I agree. That's exactly right. Right. The first position I outlined was trying to give us an account of work as the antithesis of contemplation, but that doesn't really hold up for us. For a lot of us, actually, the most thoroughly contemplative moment we'll have in life, the highest exhilaration of having gone beyond ourselves, will be in this making of some good thing. And poetry is a paradigm of that, as Plato says that himself, actually. But it's a paradigm, which means that it makes most obvious something that actually can be present in other circumstances as well. And I'll just say briefly, in my experience, at the age of 17, when I was hired by some neighbors to build a brick walkway, a path around the side of their house, that was up to that point the greatest experience I'd had in life, precisely because it was a full giving over of myself to this one task to be done. And it was neither thoughtless labor, nor maybe pure contemplation, but it was something that had a little bit in common with both. I think that's right. Gene?
I'm gonna pick up on that. Those remarks and Tony's question. I was wondering if you think, given what you've said, that you think that contemplation and mass production are then fundamentally antithetical, if not antithetical.
Well, that's the thrust of the passage from Maritain, and that's how John Paul II picks it up in Laborum Exercens. That's a weird encyclical, Laborum Exercens, because it's writing about work just at a time when work is increasingly rendered white-collar, right? So the decline of manufacturing has set in, and yet John Paul II seems to be there trying to envision what would a manufacturing kind of work, a making kind of work, look like if it's going to be in accord with human dignity. And he would probably explicitly reject, for instance, the meatpacking plants, where the pace of labor is accelerated specifically to make the work awful so that you can have a six-month turnover so you don't ever have to give anybody a raise. So that sounds, I mean, for sure. I think I'm going to stop with that. Oh, Eric.
So I'm trying to better understand, right, your opening with the comments in relation to the current state of mm-hmm. politics and mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. and the rest of your talk. And so mm-hmm. I guess my question is can politics be a craft? And then if so, how would a pursuit of justice, whether you want to call it activism, mm-hmm. or not, need to carry itself differently in mm-hmm. order to realize itself as a craft?
Yeah, so there were three premises asserted in that early part of the talk. The first was that the campus was politicized. The third was that there was nothing beyond politics. But the middle one was the important one, the most important one. And that was that the definition of what politics is that was accepted or in or being put into effect was the specifically Marxian one that said politics is about nothing but power. So I think we've talked about this before. If you give me Aristotle's definition of politics, I'll tell you everything's political, and I'll say that's a good thing. But it's the Marxist conception of politics as the exposing or the taking of power that's all that politics that counts as politics that I most fervently object to. Uh-huh.
Because if you sat around like all day, like how to make a walkway and not actually build it.
Yeah.
Kind of, like, meaningless in a sense.
Uh-huh. Yeah, it would be, right? I mean, which is one of the ways you know that building a walkway can't be the meaning of your life as a whole. Because if it were, then you actually could think about it in peace. But that's I think that's absolutely right. I mean the two things to say about that is one, slightly more modern, the medieval conception of the contemplative life, deeply integrated prayer and work, right? Ora and labora, prayer and work become the two governing dimensions of the monastic life, which then understands itself as the closest we can get to heaven on earth. But also in Plato's Symposium, Plato has a conception of this, and it's related to Eric's question, actually, because for the way Socrates and Diotima talk about the ascent of the philosopher to beauty, to the absolute, it's just like in the Phaedrus, except in a couple different elements. And here's one of the differences. He says, the ascent of the philosopher up to the contemplation of beauty, once you're in the presence of beauty, you then begin to give birth in beauty. That the life of contemplation is actually not something you ever depart from, but once you attain to it, you actually enter into different kinds of activity. And the specific examples he gives us are writing, so giving birth to beautiful words, and then giving birth to laws and entering into politics, founding cities. So How that's to be understood has varied from time to time. Some people would call it a gratuity. I think it actually is telling us something really important about anything genuinely beautiful, genuinely good, and genuinely true, which is that these things are always intrinsically self-diffusive. They're always fruitful. And so in fact, a true contemplation, as far as we, a true contemplation totally closed in upon itself would be sterile and ugly. We want self-expression in some way. The question in our day is mere productive activity good in itself, or is there something about the ability to contemplate the truth and then to be fruitful in consequence of it? And there's a big difference there, right? Knowing the truth and living in light of it, or not knowing the truth and just being busy. That's the contrast there. And that's what Pieper is trying to warn us against, is losing that former version of contemplation and action. Oh, Mark.
So this is all provoking thought in my mind, but connected to several of these questions, particularly Tony and Aaron's questions. So here's the way I'm going to frame it as a question to you. This is something that seems to me part of the distinctly differently Christian way of thinking about this craft as engagement with reality. But maybe it's not. Maybe you see some of this in Plato that I haven't seen. But the thought is that something you experience in working with hands and crafts, or at least in my experience in writing poetry, is that when you, right, you have a kind of thought, right, that gets you going, or you have a kind of agenda that you want to implement with power. But as you actually come to grips with reality, there's resistance in the medium. And because there's resistance in the medium, you know that there's reality in it, and you respond to that, right? And in a sense, that's how, in the process of craft making, you come to recognize reality as something that that you are responding to and changing your sort of, you know, pure ideal agenda to actually interact with and produce something richer. And so I think this is part of I think the part of the distinctly Christian understanding of that is that that resistance of reality is in fact a gift. And I think this enters into the way John Paul talks about the part of the value of suffering in work. That the reality that doesn't permit you to believe that it's all about you and your agenda is a kind of grace. I think that would be part of Aristotle's understanding of politics too, right? That it's because it requires a certain kind of experience in which you begin to recognize the limits and the demands upon action that come from the limits on action, right? That you then are actually doing something that counts as action in politics.
Yeah, I'm with you on all of that except for the initial way you were formulating it, which just sounded too dualistic to me.
That's why I started that way,
because
I wanted to
hear you. Eliot in Tradition of Individual Talent says someone will say something like this. The works of the past are of no application to the making of some new thing, because we know so much more than the people in the past did. And Eliot replies, yes, that's true. They are what we know. As in, the present, the new thing in the world, is never more than a millimeter thickening of what's already come before. And so every act of human making is, in fact, first receiving a gift from behind itself. It's the gift of tradition and conventions that make possible the present moment of some new making. And of course, behind that is the gift that we're talking about in the world today of creation, of being itself, being present there. And then recognizing that those conventions and traditions are already embedded in a coherent and created world. Yes, there will be resistance there, but and I like the way you put it. I think of it as not really finding resistance, but actually just becoming attentive to the fullness of things, which of course, as every teenager knows, involves testing limits. But I mean, I think of the example of Michelangelo, who just looked into the uncut marble and could see the shape that the form, that the marble had to take. That's not a guy who said, I'm just gonna chisel here and then maybe, and then suddenly, oh, I guess I have to make this David. No, he looks and he sees, he knows what the material wants to become in conformity with its nature. And so I just don't, so I'm, again, I'm with you with everything except that I wouldn't wanna emphasize the limit part because it feels too dualistic to me.
But that's, I mean, that's partly though how meter and form works, right? You, I mean, in a certain sense, that's why we talk about the muse, right? Because you are trying to say something that you, you know, might have one way of saying, but you're trying to make it work in this form, and that in itself reveals to you the words that you need.
Mm-hmm. So we were talking about John Crow Ransom earlier. That's how John Crow Ransom described the act of verse making. He said, you have your scientific prose content and you gotta cram it into the irrelevant texture of verse. What an awful way to think about poetry. As Steph will argue to you, verse form arises out of the natural conditions of English speech. You almost couldn't have invented it. Iambic pentameter is just such a fulfillment of the native potencies of how we speak. If we spoke a different language, we'd have a different meter. But the language we speak, iambic pentameter fulfills. And there's 100 years, not tonight, but another time, I'd be happy to go through the whole 100 years of the development of English prosody, where you might say they're testing limits, they're seeing out how different things work, but what they're really trying to figure out is, well, we no longer speak the language of Beowulf, but that's the only poetic equipment we've got, so what's the equipment that's actually in natural conformity with how we speak? And it took 200 years to it was figured out twice. Chaucer figured it out all by himself, then everybody couldn't understand Chaucer anymore, so they had to rediscover it, and then Sir Philip Sidney is the first perfect practitioner of English verse. And but what he's figuring out is not how I can badger this resistant meter or material. He's figuring out how does language want to unfold so that it has its perfect form.